This is the drug, lysergic acid diethylamide, popularly known as LSD. If you haven't heard of LSD, you will.
LSD was a uniquely powerful drug about which little was yet known. It was still legal. Just a small amount could produce wild hallucinations, dubbed psychedelic or mind reveal. Eight Miles High was the first public appearance of a psychedelic scene which had been growing in California over the previous few years. At its center was a young writer.
To me, it's always been proof of a god that you can kind of sense intelligence up there. God saying, hey, they're squared up over in America. Let's see what we can do with them. And Gabriel says, hey, send them some of that new stuff we just developed.
Yeah. Tonight's acid test will remain embarked on its perilous voyage the remainder of the night. That's right. Just as you feared.
The acid tests were a way of getting people together, going through what can be a hellish experiment, and finding that there's people around you who are doing the same thing, and it's positive.
There, just in front of his eyes for a minute, materialized for a minute, the tiniest thing.
Ken Kesey's acid initiation ceremonies were wild, chaotic events. There were light shows, improvised happenings, and musical interludes from a local R&B band.
They were a hairy, bad-looking bunch of guys. I wasn't that interested in their music, but I sure thought that they were on their way to no good.
What we did was R&B plus a large amount of weirdness inserted into it, you know. And we just didn't seem to be able to not do it, you know. I don't know why we started doing it. It just started coming up, you know. And so all of a sudden we would be doing a simple R&B song and it would turn into this 20-minute thing.
Jerry Garcia was well known on the San Francisco music scene. He had played in both folk and blues bands. Now he added LSD to his list of influences.
Improvisation was the first thing I learned about music. I mean, the first concept that was introduced to me was improvise. You know, it was like, for me, it was like what music was, really. You know, when you played, you made it up as you went along.
Even if the bands were playing, there was always something else going on in another corner where there would be crowds of people involved watching Neil Cassidy toss a hammer in a strobe light. Or crawling into the speakers. Huge puddles of people would crawl into the speakers and lie there and just stare at the sky or the ceiling. And it was just the most diverse collection of experiences that you could put in one room.
Here came this businessman by, and he saw all these funny-looking people there, and he says, what is this? We said, it's an acid test. He says, what does it cost? He said, it's a dollar. It's a dollar. He said, okay. He paid his dollar, and he came on in. And at about 11 o'clock, as usual, we passed out the acid. About an hour later, you saw him, and his eyes were swimming around in his head, and he saw a shadow on the floor, and he says, look to the shadow, and he says, the king walks, and he walks like this, and he puts his umbrella over his shoulder. He says, the king turns around, and he says, now the king dances. Pretty soon he was dancing with these little hippie girls, swirling around and having a great time, and I've often wondered what came of this guy.
I love my heart and San Francisco. I love my heart.
In January 1966, Kesey and his friends, the Merry Pranksters, staged a three-day acid test in San Francisco, a city which, ever since the wild days of the Gold Rush, had reveled in nonconformity.
San Francisco has always been, I think even from its earliest days, filled with crazy people. It's a seaport. One of the around the world, mostly seaports is where things happen most, because people from other cultures were continually going through them, you know. So ideas would get interwoven, and that probably has something to do with it.
San Francisco.
In the 50s, it had been the capital city of the beatniks. The bars and bookshops of North Beach had been full of pot, poetry, folk and blues. Now the young hipsters greeted this new music with open arms. At first, it was just a small scene, centered on an old Victorian neighborhood on the edge of Golden Gate Park. But before long, Haight-Ashbury was to boast the world's first psychedelic shop, its first psychedelic newspaper, and its leading psychedelic bands.
Just about every day on a sunny day, there'd be drummers down here drumming and people settling into their LSD trip. I mean, a lot of people took their first trips in Golden Gate Park and had that cheery, smiling community feeling that things are going to be pretty darn good. We're going someplace. Wait a minute,
Mark, what you doing? Everyone was influenced by the idea of doing basically two things. One, end the war in Vietnam. And secondly, start a whole new model of living in America.
The hippies are capable of extremely hard work, even though they tend to approach work as the rest of us do sport. Some of them are very successful. This is the house of a popular local band which plays hard rock music. They call themselves the Grateful Dead. They live together comfortably in what could be called affluence.
Do you think that your movement or your idea, the hip idea, is essentially connected up with drugs?
Yeah, I would say that's a large part of the framework.
I think that most of the people who are hippies now came to it through drugs.
Yeah, but it's not a dope movement. We're not trying to
spread dope. I think, personally, that the more people turn on, the better world it's going to be.
We were talking before about a way of being, and one of the ways of achieving that being is through drugs.
We were the mayors of the Haight-Ashbury. Our front steps, the town hall, it was just busy all the time. The doors were always open to everybody. The Grateful Dead lived on the stoop, which is on the front steps. And we just hung there. It was just an amazing neighborhood. And Janis lived right down the street, and Big Brother, the rest of her band was around the corner, and Boss Gags and Steve.
Big Brother and the Holding Company had originally come from the local blues scene, but now they started to develop a much more eclectic sound.
We played a lot of things. We played Hall of the Mountain King from the Peer Gynt Suite of Grieg, and we played a tune called Bacon, or we thought about it. I'm not sure
that
if this is conceptual
art.
And we were going to put a hot plate on the amplifier and cook bacon and play the song until the bacon was done.
And actually, later that was done by the Grateful Dead.
Microphone the bacon cooking. Yeah. It all played straight blues, you know, and there's just so much you can do with that to a certain degree, you know. We wanted that other step beyond.
Yeah, it's like blues and technicolor or something.
Yeah, blues and technicolor.
In May 1966, they were joined by a new lead singer who had sung the blues all the way from Texas.
The thing that makes this what they call the San Francisco music scene, as far as I'm concerned, is like, first of all, the freedom to create here. You know, for some reason, like a lot of musicians ended up here and ended up together and had complete freedom to do whatever they wanted to, and so they came up with their own kind of music. What do you think, Sam? That's what we call love music, baby.
I think we're the perfect band for her because we didn't channel her into this real structured activity that we had all prepared. You know, if she would have gone to Los Angeles and joined the Mamas and Papas, which it was bandied about at one time, or Taj Mahal's band or whatever, she would have been put into this very structured place because they were all very accomplished musicians and they knew what they were doing. And but with us, she could develop because we didn't know anything either, but we had a lot of enthusiasm. And